Bible this morning, I'd like you to open to the book of Matthew chapter 9. I'm going to be jumping around just a little bit this morning. Usually don't do that very much, but a few different places that we need to be to get to where we're going to be. We know of a lot of the miracles that Jesus did, and some of those miracles, were in control of nature. Or calming the storm, or maybe feeding the 5,000, or Jesus walking on water, or the fig tree withering, and the huge catch of fish off the side of the boat, or maybe the water and the wine. Those are all amazing miracles that Jesus did. And he also healed a lot of people. Of course, there was the man with leprosy, and the Roman centurion's servant, Peter's mother-in-law, and the man with palsy. There were several blind people that he healed, and cast the devils out of, and there's a lot of things that Jesus did, a lot of miracles that he took care of, and people saw those things happen. If you think about each and every one, each one had a purpose even for today, that why he did that. It wasn't just for that person's illness. If you look closer, though, and see the compassion, I think, that Christ had on these people, I think if you look closer and see the love that he had for them, you will see more than just a healing, or more than just the miracle that happened. But there are some specific miracles I do want to look at this morning, and all three of them have something in common. And the first one we find here in Matthew chapter 9, and it's in verse 18, when we go forward there. So it says, as Jesus was saying this, the leader of the synagogue came and knelt before him. He says, "My daughter has just died," he said, "but you can bring her back to life again if you just come and lay your hand on her." I could stop right there and probably preach all morning, but this leader, Jairus, had enough belief, to believe that Jesus could be, just right by and put his hand on his daughter. He said, "My daughter's done died. She's dead. They didn't just touch her." So Jesus and his disciples, they went up and went with him. Of course, on the way, they find the lady with the issue of blood, which is a whole other miracle. She just touched the hem of his garment and was healed from her affliction. But as he went on and Jesus arrived at the official's home in verse 23, he said he saw a noisy crowd and he heard the funeral music. So this crowd had gathered around the house. He heard the funeral music. They knew she was there. They were already having the funeral. The paid mourners were there, and the Jewish custom was, if there weren't enough mourners, they would pay mourners to come and mourn at a funeral, okay, and wail out. And so they were already there, they were already praying, and Jesus goes up and says, "Get out." And he told them that the girl is dead, she's only asleep. But the crowd laughed at him, as you can imagine. And after the crowd was put aside, however, Jesus went in, he took the girl by the hand, and she stood up. The report of this miracle swept through the entire countryside. So Jesus goes in, this girl, she's dead, she's laying there on the mat, and he takes her hand, and she just simply stands up. This girl, they're already having her funeral, okay? And they already could see that she was dead, and he just touched her, and she stood up. So that minute, the miracle swept through the countryside. People heard all about it. Can you imagine how fast that spread? Hey, there's somebody about Jairus' daughter. She was dead. This guy goes in and just touches her, and she's alive. She's still. She brought her out. Gave her back to her dad. She was alive. Can you imagine how fast that spread? Now, they were not wearing it, didn't they? It still spread really fast, okay? So we find here that Jesus has the power over death. We know he has the power over affliction, over sickness, even possession. But here we find that our Jesus, with a simple touch, can bring somebody back to life. It's cool, isn't it? Stay where that's recorded. So why don't you turn with me somewhere else? Why don't you turn to Luke chapter 7? And I want you to see something more. If you'll find verse 11. It says, "Soon after Jesus went with his disciples to the village of Nain, and a large crowd followed him." So obviously people had already heard something was going on. There's a large crowd following. "A funeral procession," okay, "was coming out of the approach as they approached the village gate." Funeral, right? They're all lined up. fixing to bury this little boy. This lady was a widow, and this was her only son. He had passed away. He was dead. It says, when the Lord saw her, look what happened. His heart overflowed with compassion. This is Jesus, okay? His heart overflowed with compassion. And he basically went to her and said, don't cry, he said. And he walked over to the coffin. He touched it, and the bearer stopped. Young man, he said, I tell you, get up. Then the dead boy sat up and began to talk, and Jesus gave him back to his mother. Listen to what happened. Great fear swept through the crowd, and they praised God, saying, a mighty prophet has risen among us, and God has visited us with his people today. And news about Jesus spread throughout Judea and all the surrounding countryside. So here we find Jesus walking up to a funeral procession. They carry this little boy out in the coffin. There's a large crowd. And he walks over, lays his hand on the coffin, and says, young man, I tell you, get up. The little boy sits up and starts talking. Okay? He takes this little boy and hands him back to his mother alive. There's a huge crowd who saw all of this. And they were in fear because they didn't know exactly what had happened. But then they realized that God had done something in front of them this very day. That's what they said. God is visiting his people today. It says this news swept all through the countryside that Jesus had the power over death. So, let's look at the Bible. Turn with me to the book of John. In the 44th verse, in the 11th chapter of John, there's 44 verses. I'm not going to read them all, because just for the sake of time. Most of you know who Lazarus is, right? Most of you have learned the story of Lazarus that we did in Vacation Bible School. We find Lazarus, he's sick. He lived in Bethany with his sisters, Mary and Martha. You might remember them. And this is the same Mary who later poured an expensive perfume in the Lord's feet and wiped it with her hair. Her brother, Lazarus, was very sick. So the two sisters sent a message to Jesus telling him, Lord, your dear friend is very sick. So we know that Lazarus was a friend of Jesus. We know that Mary was a friend of Jesus. We know that Martha was a friend of Jesus. They sent a word to Jesus saying, Lazarus is really, really sick. We need you to come. And so when Jesus heard about it, he said, Lazarus' sickness will not end in death. No, it happened for the glory of God, so that the Son of God will receive glory from this. And so although Jesus loved Martha, Mary, and Lazarus, he stayed where he was for the next 2 days. And finally, he said to the disciples, let's go back to Judea. And so they did. They go back to Judea. And you can read through that if you want to and see all the details. He finds out Lazarus is dead. He gets back to where they are, and they carry him up to the tomb, and he tells Martha that their brother will rise again. And Jesus told him, he said, I am the resurrection and the life. Anyone who believes in me will live even after dying. Everyone who lives in me and believes in me will never, ever die. Do you believe this, Martha? And this is exactly what he told her. And she said, yes, Lord. And she said, I've always believed you in the Messiah. And so Jesus goes up to where Lazarus is. They roll where he's buried. He's in a tomb, a stone rolled in front of him. And Jesus asks, where have you put him? And they carry him up there. And Jesus says, roll the stone aside. And he did. And Jesus said this in verse 40. Didn't I tell you that you will see God's glory if you believe? And so as the stone rolled aside, Jesus looked up at heaven and said, Father, thank you for hearing me. You always hear me. But I said it out loud for the sake of all these people standing here so that they will believe you sent me. And then Jesus shouted, Lazarus, come out. And the dead man came out. His hands and feet bound in grave clothes, his face wrapped in a head cloth. And Jesus told him, unwrap him and let him go. I don't know about y'all, but that's not one, not two, but three people my Jesus raised from the dead. That's three people who were clinically dead. Lazarus, they didn't say, look, he stinks, he's been here so long. And Jesus called his name, and he came out. The little girl, he touched, he just grabbed her hand, and she stood up. The little boy in the coffin, he just laid his hand on the coffin and says, just rise up. Just that simple. That's my Jesus. He has the power over death. He has the power to give life. And then you want to tell Martha, Lord, those of you who believe in me will have life even after this one. this is our Jesus, the power that he has. And who are we to say, well, my little sickness can't be healed? And who am I to say, I've sinned way too much for Jesus to be able to forgive me? Because he has the power. It's as simple as the question he asked Martha, do you believe? Do you believe? Do you believe Jesus died on the cross for your sins? Do you believe he has the power to overcome death and hell? Do you believe he has the power to heal you or heal someone in your family? Do you believe he is who he said he is? All these crowds saw all this happen. Eyewitnesses everywhere. They were scared. They were afraid. They didn't know what to do. But they knew something had happened. Just like when you give your heart to Christ, you don't understand it, but you know something's happened. That my God is big enough to forgive. My God is big enough to heal. He's big enough to feel compassion and love. Do you realize how much he loves you? Do you realize when he looked at that widow and saw that it was her only son, it tore his heart up and he said, I love her so much, I love him. And he gave him his life back. He gave him the life. Just by a few words, it was easy for him. That's our Jesus. And so many times we put so much limitations on God. Well, God, I don't know if you can do that or not. There is absolutely nothing God cannot do because he has the power to do it. That includes forgiving you of anything you've done. That includes healing your body. That includes healing your friends or your loved ones. It's how powerful he is. And we cannot limit the power that God has. And we do limit it by not believing that he can do it. Anybody that believes on him by his name will have life. I want to show you a few verses. Romans 8:39 says this. It says, no power in the sky above or in the earth below, indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord. Nothing in this world or anywhere else for that matter, in space, it doesn't matter. Nothing can separate us from the love that God has for us. You see that this morning, that God loves you so much that he died on the cross for you. He loves you so much that he stands between you and God because his blood is what covered our sin. Do you see that if you simply believe that he is who he said he is, that you have eternal life, you will have life. There's a lot of people in this world that just exist. They're not living. They're just going through the motions, through the routines of life. They're not alive in God because they don't fully believe. What would it take to make you fully believe? Would you have to see someone raised from the dead? Hey, what would happen if we were in house, you were home this morning, and somebody walked up and there was a body there, they laid their hand on the car on the side of the coffin and said, arise! And they sat up and started talking. What would you do? You'd freak out and you would run because you think, well, zombie apocalypse, I don't know, something's coming. You'd freak out and you would run because you didn't understand, you didn't know what was going on. God has the power to raise the dead. Period. Martha even asked, she said, Lord, I know that we'll all rise again when you come back. And he said, no. He said, Lazarus is going to live today. I'm not talking about the resurrection. I'm talking about you can be alive today by putting God in here and believing. You can have life. I'm not saying you have stuff. I'm not saying you're going to win the lottery or do all this stuff. Don't be playing the lottery. It's a joke anyway. What I am saying is you will have life more abundantly. You will have the things in life that matter when you put God in here. You will be his, and he will be yours. The love and the compassion that he felt on those people is the same love and compassion he feels on you. Look, I got saved when I was 21, but before I was saved, now that I look back and see the little things that God put in my life to nudge me and direct me toward him later, and I didn't know him. I was just as lost as I could be. I was that ship without a sail. I was just existing and just drifting through life, and I didn't even know him, but he knew me. And he was putting things in my life for me to guide me and direct me to get me where he wanted me to be, and I didn't even see it because I didn't know him. But now that I know him, I look back and I see those things in my life, and I'm so grateful that he intervened, and I didn't even care. But he did. God said he loves us so much, even though we may not even acknowledge him. That compassion that he has, the love that he has, it's amazing. I don't know why, but he does. 2 Corinthians 12:9 says this. He said, each time he said, my grace, this is my grace is all you need. My power works best in weakness. So now I'm glad to boast about my weakness so that the power of Christ can work through me. Jesus' grace, God's grace is all you need. That's it. That's all you need. And in our weakness, and God's listening up because this is really fair around here. We don't have to be weak, dude. We're going to be tough and be strong. In our weakness is where we'll find God's strength. We can humble ourselves. We can drop the pride. We can throw that out the window and humble ourselves and get real with God and believe we will find his strength. We'll find his power. There's nothing that can separate us from that. But we have to be humble. And we have to find our weaknesses and let God be strong when we're weak. Because so many times we're so prideful and we're trying to help cover up our weak spots. God already knows them. And the devil knows them too. That's right where he likes to attack. We have to be more and accept the power that Christ has and let it work through us. Romans 6:7 says, for when we died with Christ, we were set free from the power of sin. And we can use that word power right there because sin has power. What doesn't it? What does the Bible say about Satan? He's like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may what? Devour. And the power of sin will be just that. It will devour you. My God's power is stronger than the power of sin. My God's power is stronger than the power of temptation. My God's power is strong enough to raise people from the dead. It's strong enough to save me when I was dead in sin and give me life in him. It's the same for you too. That's how strong he is. That's how much power he has. There's nothing in this world that can tame it. When God's people believe and get cut loose with it, there's nothing that can stop it. When God's people believe and can turn it loose. But the problem is, do you believe? That's what he asked Martha. Do you believe? We want to. We say we do. But do we? Do we truly, truly believe that he's who he said he was? Romans 6:11 says, you also should consider yourselves to be, listen, dead to the power of sin and alive to God through Christ Jesus. You should consider yourself to be dead to sin, but alive because of Christ and the power that he has. Do you know that on that cross of Calvary, the world changed? It will never be the same again. Just because the beating, the scourging, the crown of thorns and the nails have held him on the cross, when Jesus died on that cross, this world could have ended right there. But it didn't. Because he has compassion on you and he loves you. This world changed at the cross, but it changed at the tomb also because that tomb was empty. When Jesus rose on that third day, he's done something that nobody's ever done on the face of this earth before. He become the Messiah, Savior. He become your Savior. Do you realize nowhere in history is there any account of anybody raising anybody from the dead? Not Muhammad, not Buddha, not any of the Indian gods, not anybody has ever raised anybody from the dead but Jesus. And I'll tell you something right there. And no record of anything has anybody ever raised anybody from the dead except for Christ. Do you understand what that means? He has the power to give us life. He has the power to let you live and be free from the bondage of sin. Jesus alone is the only one. We are much more than what we seem to be because Christ has had compassion on us. He wants to take your hand and say, rise. He wants to lay his hand on you and say, sit up, get up. He wants you to be alive and not dead in sin, not dead in the water. He wants to do a mighty work through you, and he's let you come this far simply because he wants to use you for his glory. My lawnmower died. Last time my lawnmower died, it's dead. My yard was about this tall this week. I mean, I was telling people to blow hay off of it. You know, it's just waiting for it. I literally reseed itself, is what I said. And, of course, I had a very friendly neighbor come over and mowed it for me. I think he got tired of looking at it. But he came with a huge mower. I didn't get to talk to him until he did. And he mowed it, which was cool. And so it saved me some time this week. Just thank the Lord for him having a great big mower. But my boss said, I have a mower, and it's down in the weeds behind the store. And he said, if you love them and use them, just go get them. These are some parts, ones about it, and this, and that. And so yesterday I went and got it, and I got off work, and Keith came and helped me load it. And so I took it home, helped me get some stuff done, helped me use a while. And I put parts off of mine, put on that one, and got it running, and got it looking pretty good this time. But I got it pressure washed, and it had been sitting in the weeds. And the whole time I'm working on this mower, it's hot outside, and I'm sweating. And the whole time I'm working on this mower, it just dawned on me, this is just like me. And I was in the weeds, I wasn't being used, I was just sitting there. And he pulled me out and slowly started working on me. Put a part here, a part there. And before long, that mower got to run, and before long, it was just ready to mow. It's ready to be used, it's ready to serve. And the tears just run down my cheeks because I realized how much God loved me to work on me and get me where he wanted me. And this silly lawnmower, God showed me the compassion he had for me and the love he has for me. And you know what? I have weaknesses. And in those weaknesses, I'm going to see God's strength. Because he's still working on each of us. And I'm not afraid to admit it. But just like that old lawnmower, the parts just seem to fit. And as I worked on it a little bit more, seemed to be a little better. And I can just see me and God doing it way with me. He's still working on us. He still has a job for us to do. My grass being cut, I had to have a mower. He's got a job for us to do. My question is, do you believe? So we asked Martha, do you believe? Do you believe? So I'm going to ask you that same question this morning. Do you believe? Do you believe in the power that Christ has? Do you believe? Do you want to pray with me this morning? In this room, I don't have to. I know you do, and I pray you've already spoke. Just hide me behind the cross. But have your way. We all have weaknesses that need to be shored up, and Father, I know your strength. Lord, we lean on you and depend on you comes through those weaknesses. Let us lay pride aside this morning, Father, and let us humble ourselves before you.